Previously on the Dennis Daniels Show.
You know what, Karen? I'm going to tell this to you right now. I don't think Suigintou's that tough. I mean, let's face it. Who is even intimidated by a worthless, meaningless, insignificant pile of junk?
Pile of junk? Is that what you called me? I am not a pile of junk. And I will show it to you. You will be very sorry for what you say, Mr. Daniels. Because you know what? You might think I'm broken, but you will be broken soon.
Karen, are you cold? I just felt this chill go down my body.
Whew. Yeah, you. I would close your windows tonight.
Yeah, I see. It's a black feather. She's following me.
From Daniel Studios in Cincinnati, Ohio. It's the Dennis Daniel Show. And now here's your host. He is Cincinnati's next big radio personality, Mr. Dennis Daniel.
Was not my idea. I look like freaking Hunter Hearst Helmsley with his blue blood from Connecticut, Derek. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and children of all ages, it's me, it's the good old Double D, and you have found Blog Talk Radio's hottest talk show, The Dennis Daniels Show. I am your host and Blog Talk Radio World Heavyweight Champion. What's the point? Dennis Daniel, by the way. I'll tell you what, the last couple of weeks, this show has just gone down the toilet. And I think I kind of know why. So for those of you who just tuned in, well, welcome to the show. You know, take your coat off, kick back, relax. It's going to be kind of like this for a while. Well, the last show we had in February, we had Karen Strassman on the air. Of course, very nice voice actress, very talented, by the way. Well, I decide to poke the bear a couple too many times. That means I open my mouth, insert foot, and it would appear that I have been cursed by Suigintou. That's right, the little Rozen Maiden doll, you know, like this tall, you know, apparently she put a curse on me. I guess that broken line, you know, actually came to true. Well, everywhere I go, glass shatters, there are black fathers everywhere, and worse off, you know, I'm not in the mood for WrestleMania. I know, isn't that crazy? It's this curse, I tell you. So anyway, tonight on the Dennis Daniels Show, I brought someone that might be able to help me out. Well, she comes with someone that's going to be our guest, the very talented Mela Lee. Now, everyone knows Mela Lee best as the voice of the snotty, bratty Rozen Maiden doll, Shinku. And, you know, I didn't think this would be a big problem. So I've spent the last couple of weeks looking for Belle Dandy. Apparently, she didn't like how Poison introduced me and interrupted her during the last program, so I can't find her. And not only, and this is how important she is to this program, not only is she in charge of, you know, doing the announcing, she's also in charge of guest relations. She makes sure every guest has what they need, water, snacks, you know, she is comfortable. Well, I'd take over the responsibilities for her because, you know, I can't find her. And I get stuck with this little brat from hell. So first off, she doesn't like the bottle of tea we have. So I have to run out and find this special oolong tea, you know? And this is how stupid pricing is nowadays. I had to go to 3 Whole Food outlets to find this tea, and it cost me $75. Are you kidding me? $75? So I go, okay, what the heck? Buy it, give it to her. Apparently, our doilies aren't good enough. So I have to drive to 6 party cities. It felt like 6. I can't even remember how many. To find these special Kun Kun doilies. $100. Okay. No problem. Business deductible. Yeah. Well, then I find out she doesn't like the decorum of the studio. I'm being told by a guest they don't like the decorum in my studio. Apparently, the hanging Mr. Sacco, the Blog Talk Radio Championship belt, the various photos with my celebrity guests, they all gotta go. She's right now using my belt as something to hold the teapot on. I want to scream, but I need her help. And if that wasn't enough, she doesn't like the suit I'm wearing. So I have to go to like 5 different costume shops in Cincinnati. And do you know how hard it is to find an open costume shop in the middle of March and they're still open at this time of night? Very rare. So here I am dressed like Baroque or whatever. I don't even know what I am anymore. Ugh, I have sold out to my guests. This show used to have some principles.
Yeah, right.
Well, anyway, let's talk back about Mela Lee. Very talented voice actress, very talented singer. But you know, I can't do enough justice just talking about her. So let's take a quick look at a small demo reel of some of her best-known roles and find out what makes Miss Lee so cool.
June, it is too early for such an outburst.
Whatever. Don't know what the point is with all your lecturing anyway.
Disciplining the servants is an important duty for a lady. Pay attention, Inichigo. As my servant, you must not come any closer to me than this. You will answer me with a yes, not an ooh, a yes. Come now, time for breakfast. You will use this to open doors for me. Pay attention, your foot has encroached on my space. That is unacceptable. Honestly, whose room do you think this is?
I'm not going to let you marry my dad.
Huh?
If you guys want a date, that's fine. But I'm not going to let you marry him. That's a promise.
I thought you might be somewhat reticent about it. But I didn't think you'd be so blunt as to reject it outright.
You knew from the beginning that I wasn't going to support this? How did you know?
Well, it was pretty obvious. Every time the two of our eyes met, you ran away immediately. Just out of curiosity, would you mind telling me what it is you don't like about me?
I hate everything about you. Your clothes, your makeup, even your smell.
Well, that works out well, because I hate you too. I guess that makes us even, doesn't it, you snot-nosed little brat? Don't mess with me, kid. I promise you'll regret it.
Don't ever step foot in my house again. And as far as the marriage goes, it's never gonna happen.
Archer, have you been able to detect the presence of other servants?
Must I remind you of my class? I'm sorry, but I don't have the power to detect enemies far off in the distance.
That's right. It's only the caster class who has the ability to detect enemies long before they approach. Come on. Let's find out for ourselves what's going on out there. So, what do you think of the view? Pretty amazing, isn't it?
You're right, it's a great spot. If we'd come here first, we could have completely avoided our trip through the city.
But all you can see from up here is the city's layout. You can't get a sense of Fuyuki City unless you experience those places in person. If I offended you, I apologize.
But at the same time, I can't have you gaping in awe at every extraordinary thing that's about to happen in this city.
I've been ready for this day to come for 10 years now.
I'm relieved to hear you say that, Rin.
So a pretty cool cat this Miss Lee is. And, of course, she's also got a brand new song out by her group, Magnolia Memoir, which we're going to talk about a little bit later on in the program. But anyway, let's get right down to this. You know, these tights are killing me. And they're cutting off circulation to important parts of my body. So hopefully I can get through this interview without passing out. My guest at this time is a very talented voice actress who is best known as Shinku from Rozen Maiden. You can also catch her brand new music video with Magnolia Memoir, Odds and Ends. And just a warning, if you see the cover band Dandelion Diary, They're absolute crap. So ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, give it up for the one, the only, Miss Mela Lee! Thank you, and welcome to the Dennis Daniel Show.
Thanks for having me.
Hey, thank you for being on. I'll tell you what. You don't got to look any further than that demo reel to see, you know, why you're just not the cat's pajamas. The cat's meow, the hoot nanny, the whole effing show, and all that other stuff that I can't think off the top of my head. But I've wanted to have you on for a while now because you play, I think, some very unique characters in anime. And not only that, but you've also got a music videos we got to talk about on the interwebs. But of course, we'll talk about that.
I'd love to.
Oh, yes, yes. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Hang on, wait one second. Stupid black feather. Things are everywhere around here. But we'll talk about that a little bit later on in the program. So what got you interested in acting?
Well, I think it'd be voice acting. I never thought I'd be in Hollywood or be an actress, and was told I had a good voice and took a class and got discovered and did a little bit of anime for a few years while I was a banker. And then I lost my job because there was a banking problem a few years back. Everybody was getting laid off. And I started doing more anime. And shortly thereafter, I was hired as Yuki Cross in Vampire Knight. And I've started to just make my complete living as a voice actress and as a music composer.
So what you're saying is that while you are a banker, you cashed in on being a voice actress, and that became your greatest asset.
I did. I was lucky enough to have a few jobs. I didn't live on it, but once I needed to, I...
Did you see the string of bank puns?
Yes.
Don't have a trombone, so, because who is it? But no, that sounds really cool that, you know, starting off as a banker, then you, again, taking some classes, and boom, now you're doing what you like to do, instead of just sitting there going, would you like, and you going, no, ma'am, I can't take that entire coin collection in pennies.
I'll tell you what. I was actually a mortgage banker, more into finance and mortgage. It'd be a lot of pennies if they bought a house with it.
Oh, yes, yes.
But yes.
Oh, but I have some experience with mortgages, and when you have that little old lady who's, you know, on the verge of losing everything, and you got to be the one to break the bad news to her, that tears at your heart. Hopefully you never had to do anything like that.
Oh, I think everybody... when you're losing your house or need to refinance it, it's sort of in that bind. You have to be very understanding. Before I was a banker, I did disaster relief. And it ironically is very similar. People find themselves in unusual situations and you have to help them out.
Man, this interview just got really sad all of a sudden.
Aww.
We can have sad interviews? No, we cannot have sad interviews. So let's...
And we won't talk about banking.
No, we will not talk about banking. Unless it's banking on this going to be an awesome episode of the Dennis Daniel Show here on blogtalkradio.com with awesome voice actress Mela Lee, who plays not only Shinku and Rozen Maiden, but also has an incredible band named Magnolia Memoir, and their hit song, Odds and Ends. The music video just got uploaded to Vevo on YouTube, so check it out after the show. Great tangent right there. That's a great... We took a bad thing, we made a good thing. Awesome. So, of course, one of your first known roles was Yuki Cross in the very popular Vampire Knight and Vampire Knight Guilty. So, were you talented? Yeah. Guilty as charged. So, what was it like working on that series, and what did you think of your character?
Oh, I was so honored. I was really excited, of course. It was my first role that resonated so universally worldwide. As you mentioned, Shinku is one of your favorite parts. It's actually one of mine. I love that story. Vampire Knight was a little different because it had such a huge fan base already. And to do Yuki Cross was wonderful, to go from being a young teenager to coming into her own as a woman. I hadn't had that opportunity with a character yet.
And it also helps to have a gun. Pew,
pew, pew, pew, pew. I was kind of badass.
Yes, it was kind of badass. You can never question the badassery of a girl with a gun, a schoolgirl with a gun. But it's a staggering the mortality rate of schoolgirls in anime with guns. That's quite a staggering number.
Oh, who's taking a sad turn now?
Oh, hey, you can't turn this. No fair.
You keep me laughing.
Oh, I am so sorry. So, yes, so Vampire Knight. Now, I've never seen the series personally, but like you said, it's got some kind of giganto following of awesomeness. And, you know, you have and it's, of course, you know, despite only being 13 episodes, it's obviously have something in it that does something that make it very popular with the audience. And again, well, you don't even got to look any further than the cast that was in that. You've got Laura Bailey, you've got Travis Willingham, you got Vic Mignogna, who's our bro, you got Wendy Lee, you got Ethan Murray, you got Mela Lee. Don't know who that is. I'm joking. But yeah, I mean, how could you not like a show with such talented cast like that?
It was pretty amazing, and just to get to do a few conventions, and we opened San Diego Comic-Con together as a cast, Ethan and Vic Mignogna and I, and it was really exciting.
Oh, yes. Well, Comic-Con, that's like the World Series of conventions, so to be there as a guest.
That was one of my first conventions, actually, so.
Oh, wow. So
I went big.
So no pressure. No pressure at all. I'm going to assume there was intense amounts of pressure.
Vic and Ethan were really sweet. They kind of walked me through it all, and I think that's what's great about having co-stars is that you're not in an anime alone, you're not in a production alone, and there's a team there. And they've been to hundreds of conventions, so they kept me calm and laughing, just like you do.
Oh, well, I don't know if I keep people laughing. That normally turns to disgust. It's more of, wait for it, dramatic pause, Suigintou's curse! Well, anyway, let's talk about this character, you know, that I think you're best known for and is the bane of my existence, just because I've had quite some characters on my show, but I think this one takes the cake. Your best known character is Shinku from the Rose Maiden series, and that includes the original Rose Maiden, the Rozen Maiden Tramund, and Rozen Maiden Overture. So tell us, what is it like playing Shinku, and what did you think of her character?
I adored her. I was a latchkey kid, so I love the story. June being left alone and these unexpected friends. But I love that she's ultimately about family and would rather have the sisters together than go to the end. And I was an only child, so I really love the theme of family. And I thought she was just adorable. I have the doll, and I have all this. My mother loved it. I think that's one of those things that resonates with your whole family. She's just beautifully drawn and beautifully executed.
Yes, I think you know, as much as a lot of the guys will go, oh boy, another girl whooping a boy around in an anime. Pass. You gotta look at the storyline, and this is a lot different from your typical boy meets girl anime, because it's a boy meets girl doll anime. But you know, you've got such a classical story. You've got classical music. It's like, you know, like 17th century meets modern day, and of course the dolls, you know, they're these entities of pure power and magic, and. And of course, Shinku is, I guess, be the protagonist of the story. She's trying to bring all the other dolls together instead of fight them and compete in the Alice game. And because, and I may just be, it may be a while since I've seen this, but I know that once you beat a doll, you can take their Rozen Mystica, and then they turn into a doll that can either talk or move. And what kind of life is that?
Terrible.
It's a terrible, but...
Terrible.
You know, but Shinku doesn't want to fight. She wants to bring the other dolls together. She wants to bring Hana Ichigo, right. Suiseiseki, Soseiseki, and yes, for some reason, even Suigintou together as a family. And I think, you know, I really was impressed with the, you know, the dramatic turns that this series took. In the last episode of the first series, when, you know, when Shinku is beating Suigintou and her dress is just coming unraveled, you see all the different parts, you know, how she's incomplete, how she's broken. And again, I gotta give it to Karen Strassman for doing an incredible job as Suigintou. Not taking anything away from you, but she just had raw energy and that passion, you know, she just brought that to the table. And I at the end, I felt so bad for her.
Well, I just think that instead of it always being who's the bad guy, who's the good guy, it showed us that the reasons behind the actions. And I think you even see that theme about being broken and being loved and kind of our misconception that we can't be loved if we're broken. And as much as June and Shinku seemed like they didn't need each other, of course they did. And one of my favorite scenes is when he puts her back together again, because she the first time she realizes that she wasn't perfect. But we find out she's still the hero. And I love that, to be reminded that you can make mistakes and be broken and still be the hero.
Yes, it's and they all come together and live happily ever after, the end. Well, I hope so. I don't know about that Bara Suisho. I don't know about her. She's got an eye patch. That's kind of creepy. She's like a Dolly pirate, but she's not. And I like how Soseiseki is dressed, you know, like a guy, but it's not. And Suiseiseki, and we had Rebecca Forstead on in 2011, and we told her I could not stand Suiseiseki. She was just such a little brat. Just
now, I know you're a fine young gentleman. Do you collect the pull-up dolls or any of the figures?
No. Come on, Mela. You really think I want a nagging doll telling me what to do here? If I wanted something to nag at me and tell me what to do here and there, I'd get a girlfriend. Hey-oh!
Technical difficulties have occurred with the hosts of this podcast. Please do not adjust your broadband connection. Thank you.
We here at the Dennis Daniels Show, our opinions and beliefs do not necessarily reflect those of Mela Lee, Anime Altogether, and Blog Talk Radio. Those are the opinions of this jackass. You know, that curse has affected me more mentally than physically. But anyway, yes, I know it's been terrible. Black feathers everywhere. My announcer left me. I don't know why. That's it. It's been one big sob story, but we'll talk more about that later on. We'll hopefully be able to put this curse to bed a little bit later on in the program. But so of course, you know, Rozen Maiden, if you guys have not seen it yet, please head over to Amazon and pick a copy up. Please do not pirate it. It's not cool. And we haven't talked about this in a while, but piracy has taken another rise in the United States. And I know that a lot of big shows are getting ready to come out right now. I mean, you got the Attack on Titan people. They're getting ready to release it in English, and they're going to be punching Titans left and right, and boo, 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 and but, you know, no one, these people work very hard on this show, so why would you want to take away from the awesomeness that is anime and make it dirty, but with your dirty, dirty pirated movie? That's sick. And without it, Mela here can't do more anime and be awesome. And
right. If you guys buy it, even if it's $3.99 or $9.99, whatever the price point is, it allows us to do more.
I mean, if you don't support the anime, if you don't buy the anime and support the industry, Mela may have to go back to being a banker. We got to emphasize that. That emphasized it. But anyway, if you guys want the complete Rozen Maiden collection, $29 on Amazon, $30. That's $10 per series. You get 12 episodes. Well, actually, you get 24 episodes and two OVAs. So that's like 26 divided by, it's like almost a dollar an episode. So, you know, and you get the very nice, you know, box that comes in. 24 episodes, 2 of 8. It's got Shinku on the cover, 5 DVDs. Hey, it'd be too good a deal not to pass up. Yes, we like plugging everything on here as much as we can. Oh, and they even have a cute little Shinku Nindroid figure for 47, and she's got a little teapot and cup, and she got a little dog case, and she's so adorable. Oh, and she has a head that with her eyes closed. So, oh, it's so cute. Man, come on, get it together. Just get together. You're a man, damn it. You're not supposed to like this crap. Darn it. Man, see, you're actually the third Rozen Maiden voice actor we've had on the show. These dolls are getting to me, man. Action figures, think action figures.
I bet.
Well, anyway, you know, okay, enough about me being, you know, let's talk about another anime that I think, you know, it's like, when you see this, you can't help but go, what the hell? And it's, I think, one of your most, you know, sinister roles, and that sounds crazy, but it's the truth. Another role you're very known for is Rena Ryuugu in When They Cry. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this was one of those animes that you gotta, you know, take a watch again, because you could not believe half the stuff that happened to this. And you play Rena. So what was it like working on that series, and what did you think of your character?
Well, I got to work with Christy Reed, and I love her as a director. She's just fantastic. But I was over at Warner Brothers, and they asked me to come audition for something, and asked me to do a scene about razor blades and pie. And it got really dark, and then they left me in the sound booth for a second, and we're talking. I could see them through the glass. And they said, well, you have a part. I said, what, huh? And I said, great, I guess we'll make a schedule. And he said, no, you're going to start in the next 15 minutes. Can you go take a break and grab some tea? And let's go. So I started the same day. And I remember how adorable she was for the first part of the episode. And I thought, why did they ask me to do this? I thought maybe someone like Sandy Fox or some really squeaky cute person would be better for it. But then she got dark. I wouldn't do that if I were you. So I thought, okay, I'm going to kick ass on this one.
Wow.
And it was great. It was great to be a little demented.
A little? Mela, that's an understatement. That's like saying a tornado is a little... Yeah, a little demented. That's like saying a tornado is a little wind. She beat someone to death with a pipe. She cut a guy's skull in half with a cleaver and smiled like it was nothing.
Well, sometimes we have tempers, you know?
Wow. I thought I had bad days. But, you know, I want to talk about this for another minute. And, you know, When They Cry, I think, you know, it is one of those animes that make you say, what the duck? But
yeah,
it's one of those animes that, you know, it's intriguing in a way. You know, you see what happens when, you know, a small city, you know, when we see the deepest, darkest fears in mankind. In Rena's case, it was losing her father to some gigolo or some gold digger. And, you know, she didn't want to do that. She didn't want to lose her father. She lost her mom to divorce. She didn't want to, you know, lose her father again. So she... I guess I can defend it. I think it was a little over the top, and killing the guy, that was not cool. But, you know, this is what happens, you know, when your town gets taken over by this evil cursed spirit and this little blue-haired girl. And if any of my friends, you know, are going to Japan and you see a blue-haired little girl and she's talking about murder and mass genocide, don't talk to her. That's not good. even though Reba does a fantastic job as Rena, but it's just one of those animes that you just gotta, you see it, you gotta turn the TV off. He's gotta just sit there for a moment or two and go, what the hell did I just watch?
Right. And that's how we were when we were actually voicing it. It's that it's just encompassing. You can't take your eyes off the screen after you've even done your own lines. It was a pretty great piece of pulp fiction.
And this is another thing that I think the show gets, you know, ripped on a lot for. The dubbing that many people say, you know, wasn't that good, and I'm sure you've gotten your fair share of, you know, and they're going, oh, the dub's not as good as the sub. So what do you think of this argument that the dub just wasn't as good as the original?
I think it was the best dub that it could have been with the budget constraints and the time constraints that the directors and the actors were given. And of course we can always do better. I think it's important that we strive to raise the art form. I mean, back in the 90s, it was awful. And at least they're giving it a go and listening to the Japanese and trying to stay with the music. Could it have been better? There's no artist that finishes a project and 2 or 3 years later thinks it couldn't have been better.
Yeah.
The fact that it got done, and at such a great cost, both Rozen Maiden and When They Cry got kind of stuck in the middle of some production companies that closed.
This was during the big shutdown, I believe, a couple. About what 2008, 2000, or 2009, 2010. This was like, you know, when Bane Zoom was slowly unrolling out or slowly closing the door on the dubbing. And this is what kills me. And back to the piracy thing, stuff like this is why it happens, because people rather download it off torrent sites instead of buying the DVD. Yeah, it's going to be a little pricey, but it ensures that stuff like what happened to Bang Zoom doesn't happen. And we were talking.
And they're thriving, by the way, again. It's just at that moment, and they're run by an amazing family, a beautiful, beautiful family, and they've stuck it out and have been great proponents of anime in Los Angeles. But it was a difficult time, and I think when people are saying, gosh, it could have been better, it also could have not been done at all. And am I proud that at an extreme cost to the production companies, they went out of the way to finish their series and not leave them undone, specifically for the fans?
Yeah, you know, and that's what kills me a lot, Mela. You guys put your heart and your soul into doing these shows. You know, you guys, I could tell you horror stories from some of my guests about shooting their voices out. There was a girl in anime who couldn't do voice acting really much anymore because she shot her voice doing a character. You guys spend extended periods in a hot booth recording it again and again and again to make sure it's perfect for the audience. And then you got Johnny Numbnuts on YouTube quoting, "What the F is wrong with this dub? This is so homo. Blah, 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 blah. Ron Paul 2012. I don't keep up with the YouTube comments. I'm lucky I'm shoveling my own negative comments out of my videos. But I think you guys don't get the credit that you guys deserve. And this even dates back to when we had Wendy Lee on the show in 2010. She was getting some real crap-ons because some guy uploaded a God Knows from Haruhi Suzumiya, and it didn't sync up with the video. And they were complaining, oh, the anime's terrible. It doesn't sync up to the mouth flaps don't move to the audio. And, you know, maybe it's just the fact that there could be an uploading problem with the video itself on YouTube. So why in the world would you attack the voice actor and actress that makes these, and when you're trying to pirate the episode? Exactly. Mm-hmm. But, you know, When They Cry...
The other side, Dennis, too, though, is that if somebody is saying terrible things, it means they really care about the series. So there's still a potential for someone who's leaving bad comments, or not bad comments, just maybe negative comments. I love that they care enough to do that. If they could turn that into supporting by buying or kindly sending letters to the production company, I think that just like every other YouTube medium, there's room for constructive criticism. And we want to hear from the fans. We want them to care that much, and we want you guys to want a better product in the end.
You know, man, I never thought of it like that, actually. I always see comments like, stupid, sucks, lame.
What do we do with that?
Yeah, exactly. Trust me. That's the story of my life with this show. You know, stupid, Dennis sucks, he's loudmouthed. That doesn't help. But there are people...
No, but it means they care enough to leave a comment.
Yeah, well, you know, sometimes, you know, sometimes I could take the latter on that. But you've got, you do make a point. There are some shows that, you know, may not be perfect, but I think it's through hearing back from the audience and the ones that do leave constructive criticism that help you, and not only you, but other voice actors grow in their field. So that's the next show you do. Yeah. Maybe you can change something different. I'm sure you've gotten plenty of times from other people you've met at cons. You know, I really liked your character, but I think she could have been voiced a different way, or maybe I could have seen someone else voice her. But I guess when it comes to When They Cry, you can just go, I've got a hatchet. Your argument's invalid.
And we had a blast. And I think anime people don't realize that it's very largely a director's medium. You know, we trust our directors and they do a great job. And it's so mathematically complicated, like a grid. And to fit the American into a Japanese flat. So there's some times where we do great, and there's other times where we might miss it a little. It's kind of like an Olympic athlete who's, you know, doing a gymnastic dismount. Every now and then, you know, they wobble. It doesn't mean they're not trying or that they can't be great. But sometimes you don't get the 10. You don't get the great score.
You get the 10 in my book, Mela.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Or you get the 10 plus.
Dennis June Daniel.
Don't call, what? Don't you dare call me June. I'm nothing like that whiny little
Oh, honestly, you love it. Admit it.
Shut up, Shinku. You're not helping your case. No. Well, no. I got some words for her at the end of the show. I got some words for her. She's going to help me out here. Well, anyway, blogtalkradio.com. This is the Dennis Daniels Show. We've got Mela Lee on the air, best known as Shinku from the Rozen Maiden trilogy.
Hi, guys.
Yes, but now we actually gotta shift our talk from anime to the fancy musics. And when I saw this, I was like, you know, we gotta talk about this because this is awesome. Now, aside from voice acting, you're also a very talented musician, and you're actually in the very talented group Magnolia Memoirs. And your first single, Odds and Ends, just came out on YouTube on Vivo as a music video. So why don't you tell us a little bit about Magnolia Memoirs and why they're better than their cover group, Dandelion Diaries.
Which is the first time hearing about Dandelion Diary. But Magnolia Memoir, when I lost my job at the bank, I kind of was really broke and decided to do a couple of things that I've always wanted to do before I really looked for a job. And my father died when I was a little girl, and I wanted to meet more of my family and learn stories about what his favorite foods were, onions and chili, and who his best friends were. And I just, I got a journal on the side of the road at a gift shop near a truck stop. It had magnolias on it. So I called it the Magnolia Memoir. And it had some great stories that made you laugh and some really sad things that I wish my mom had known. And I turned them into some songs. Ultimately, I was just going to give them to my dad's family as a gift. And the studio we were recording at, Aretha Franklin's engineer was down the hall, and Bruce Springsteen's guy, and they loved it. And they walked in and set up the session much more professionally and encouraged us to finish an album. And then we got a publishing deal. And next thing you know, the same year I was starting to work in anime and voiceover, I also had a publishing deal and became a professional musician. So it's been, I feel like Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, where I got like the last golden ticket, and I'm totally ecstatic to get to do what I do every day. Today I went to a soundstage to work on a new series, and it's really exciting. I'm very, very blessed.
Yeah, I like that. Magnolia Memoir certainly sounds better than Jasminum Journal. or the Salvia Story, or the Cacti Chronicles.
Yeah. Although Cacti Chronicles, it has a ring to it.
or what else
it
have we
could
got?
Be like Queens of the Stone Age Desert Sessions or something.
Or the Ramonda Records. or the one more the Babiniana book. The Babiniana book. I'm just
remind me not to ask you to name our next album, okay?
Well, you know what? Mela? How about we give them a little sample of this awesome song and just let's give them a taste of it. How does that sound?
I think that'd be great.
Okay. That was actually cool. I get to do my Ed Sullivan impression. Okay. Now, here to entertain you with their hit song, Odds and Ends, Magnolia Memoir. Let's bring them out. That's pretty good.
Thank you, Dennis.
And you know what? Mela Lee, more like Melody. Man, that is some. Oh, I thought you were like that. Melody. Come on, trying to be cutting edge here, Mela. But no, that was, wow, that was very, very good. You should be very proud of yourself.
Thank you. It's available on iTunes. And speaking of, piracy or whatever, I would love if someone supported us for 99 cents. We had somebody say, oh, no, I already downloaded it. And I think to myself, 99 cents? Come on.
You downloaded it.
For 99 cents, you can get the CD or the single and then leave some comments and really help us out.
Yeah. Maybe we'll have to buy a couple copies and give the codes away to some of our lucky listeners. Don't know.
I would love that.
But anyway, the song, that's just half of it. You gotta look at this music video. Unfortunately, we can't play the music video on the radio because that kind of killed the buzz of radio. But
we were so lucky.
Yeah, I had to watch this twice, and you got some great cameos in there. You've got Fred Willard. You got Patricia Heaton from Everybody Loves Raymond. How in the world did you get these people?
It's actually Doris Roberts.
Doris Roberts.
From Everybody Loves Raymond. Yeah. They all are friends of either the director or Alexander Burke, my writing partner, or myself. And we wrote the song after our last problem. We had an album that came out a couple years ago with a record label that was having some trouble. And so we got kind of shelved. And we felt like we were on a sinking ship. And when we went to Armageddon Expo in New Zealand, it inspired us to start writing again, Alex and I. And we wrote Odds and Ends about, it's all about the odds and ends and the pocket full of friends dancing on the decks as the ship's going down. And the funniest thing happened is after we wrote that song, all of our friends got together and started helping us. We now have our own record label, and the video got put together by some friends through Second City, Chicago, and Will Forte and Doris Roberts and Fred Willard, Ione Sky, those are all friends of ours that wanted to help out. So it was really cool and very inspiring. Now we have a new album coming out in the next month called Pale Fire, and Odds and Ends will be on it.
Oh, well, Mela, we'd love to plug that here on the program. Just let everyone know that, the incredibly talented voice actress Mela Lee is now the incredibly talented musician with her group Magnolia Memoir. So, guys, stay tuned to the Dennis Daniels Show and alltasteexplosion.com to find out when this album will be available for you to download on the iTunes and the Google Plays, because I don't know a man, woman, or a child alive that would not like this Odds and Ends song. Though I did really find the panoramic shot through the storage chamber there. I'm like, what? did you guys beat the Storage Wars guys for video footage? It's like one continuous.
No, actually, yeah, Alexander Burke, who's on Vibes, the red-headed guy with eyeliner, his girlfriend works for the Hand Prop Room, HPR, which is one of the largest privately held prop rooms for film and television. They do, like, swords for Game of Thrones and just some really cool stuff. She's a cool girlfriend. But she arranged for us to be able to have that location, and those are rows and rows of props filled with stuff that she lends out to the movie industry every day.
I gotta say, very, very well done. Just not only the cinematography, but just all the appearances. That must be one heck of a very long line of prop storage shelves. in order to make that video come to life.
Well, if you watch it a few more times, there are some tricks, and there are so many treasures, actually. If you keep watching it, you'll see little cameos that weren't expected and signs and things that change. And some of the stars, to be honest, in that video are the people that work at HPR. They're specifically set decorators and designers, and they set up those aisles 20 different times in one day. We were only shooting for 8 hours, so they did a great job.
Well, yeah, I think it's great, but guys, don't take my word for it. Check out our website, alltasteexplosion.com, after our interview goes live, and you'll see a link to the music video. And trust me, guys, you will not be wasting your time by checking out this awesome music video. Best 4 minutes of your day. Trust me. So, of course, you know, you seem like you've got the entire thing going on, but you're also still doing some anime, and you're actually getting ready to do a character in an upcoming series called Toradora, and that's coming out later on this summer. And you play, let me make sure my website's freezing on me, you play Maya Kihara in this all-new anime. So can you tell us a little bit about Toradora?
Well, you know, ironically, it puts me back with my director from Rozen Maiden, Alex von David.
What a coincidence!
So I'm super happy. He's a wonderful director and has such a passion for anime and for the art form and takes so much time creating it. So I really hope the fans enjoy it because I don't know of another director that I like to work with more.
Well, yeah, you got some really good, cool guys in here. You got Eric Kimmerer, Cassandra Lee Morris, Christine Marie Cabanos, who's been on the program. A lot of these. What's cool is, and you've also got Karen Strassman on this show. She's doing double duty.
I know.
Oh, man.
She's such a sweetheart. I adore Karen. We get to work sometimes on movies together in the same room, which is great. We laugh because we're in shows together, but we don't record at the same time for anime. So we don't ever really spend time together in that world. Thank goodness for film and television.
Oh yeah, definitely. I think you two have been, you know, I think just two of the more prolific voice actors, actresses that have started going into major television. It's really cool. Now, of course, alongside, you know, voice acting in anime and doing the music, you also do ADR work for several very popular shows. Some of the shows have included Entourage and Gilmore Girls, and you've done the ADR work. So maybe could you tell us a little bit about the ADR work for that? Something that you do some work for?
Yeah, I owe it all to anime. ADR is voice replacement or sometimes voice matching when an actress or an actor didn't quite get the line right due to editing or just too much noise. Maybe they're doing a scene on the ocean, and it literally is on the ocean, so you have to replace a lot of things. And when I was working at Bang Zoom, somebody said, hey, I've got a friend who does ADR and works on the Gilmore Girls, and he might be calling you. And I was so excited, and it was 2004. And in 2005 of October, so pretty much like 16 or 17 months later, the phone rang and he said, hey, you know, this is Joe. Did Sean tell you I was going to call? And I thought to myself, yeah, like 2 years ago. I was really excited to get to drive onto Warner Brothers lot and work on the Gilmore Girls and get to be a teenager and replace, work with Lorelai's voice. And also when she went to school, to Yale, to work on that part. But that's turned into a career where we've done everything from replace or help Pirates of the Caribbean, the Mermaids, and the recent Pirates of the Caribbean installment with Cindy Robinson, actually, was another one of those voice actresses in anime that helped out with singing and creating a soundscape. And today... I'm working on a series I can't talk about.
So the ones that get,
yes, but I got to be a choking 2-year-old baby.
What?
An overdose cocaine addict. I had to redo her scene where she snorts coke and then she gets sick and passes out. I got to sing, replace a voice of a 12-year-old who's got an amazing voice. And she's such a great actress, but maybe not a good singer. But that's where I can be adorable and help out the performance. And if we do it right, you guys never know we're there. But we get to see it all first. Yeah, we get to see all of these series. I was backstage at SNL a couple years ago because we had an opportunity to write for some of their digital shorts, and they had us backstage and then at the after party. And there were two actors from a Showtime series, and a girlfriend of mine was like, oh my gosh, that's so-and-so. I just want to meet him. And I thought, oh, I know how to do it. And I walked right up to them. I said, you look great on the new series. And they went, what? You've seen it? Because they'll shoot it, and then it'll be in editing for 6 months to a year sometimes for a new show. So when we're doing ADR, we actually get to see the final cuts before they get premiered to the actors and the rest of the cast and crew. Oh. So it's really exciting. We have to keep quiet about it, but we're like, oh my gosh, this is a great movie. I can't wait for you guys to see it.
Yeah, you don't want to kiss and tell. That'd be rude. But yeah, you've gotten right. to work on some incredible movies, Pirates of the Caribbean on Stranger Tides, Warm Bodies, Olympus Has Fallen. Well, someone should pick it up then. You've done stuff for The Purge, which, by the way, Karen does some screaming in The Purge.
We had a great time on that show.
I guess you guys had the urge to purge.
Yes, but in a very healthy way.
Good, yeah, yes, yes. Oh, definitely. Yeah, Entourage, Atlas Shrugged, Part 1, The Good Wife. Mm-hmm. Or Huge, Make It or Break It, Wall Street, Money Never Sleeps. See, in the case of ADR with you, greed is not a bad thing. It's a good thing. It's a Gordon Gekko joke. Again, Gilmore Girls, you've actually composed for shows like 7 Minutes in Heaven. You're actually credited on a soundtrack. You, beside her with When I Think of You, you actually performed it and you wrote for it.
It's pretty exciting. That's what I mean. I feel like Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. I wasn't the girl who was in all the talent shows growing up, and I don't have a music degree. And somehow I had enough, I guess, raw talent and the right people to help me out that I actually get to do this for a living. It's crazy beautiful. If somebody told 8-year-old Mela that you could do anime and animation and movies and film and compose for a living, I mean, what a great job. Seriously.
That's why I am so excited to be taking my first steps into this voice acting business. And
Oh, congratulations.
I haven't exactly officially started yet. I've been listening to some of my friends who are getting into it as well. I've actually got, I actually got one friend. She's actually doing some stuff for, she's actually voicing for some shows that are on Toonami right now. And that's, I'm like, oh, Jiminy Christmas. She's no older than I am. And she's already voice acting. Because originally my degree is in electronic media, and I specialize in radio, but I really want to try this, because the radio industry is kind of hurting right now, and, you know, if I got nothing better to do, then might as well try my hand at voice acting. And I have just been so nervous with getting started. I'm pretty sure that you were probably nervous as well when you first started. So I'm trying to, you know, figure out the best way to tackle this. And it seems
I remember Karen in her interview talking about being nervous up until recently. And it's true. I don't really get as much stage fright in music as I would in voiceover. For anime, it's actually much more intimate than us, but for movies, you're on a soundstage with a huge movie theater screen, and then it's kind of like in the movies where they have the music stand with your notes on it and a light, and you're in the middle of that room, and everyone's behind you, and they do the three beats, you know, beep, 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 and on the imaginary fourth beat, you start your line to picture. And it's nerve-wracking. You're literally just shaking. And Karen and I laughed that just recently we stopped being so nervous, because you're so excited to get the job and so grateful, and you want it to be good. And so I think nerves are totally natural, but clearly it doesn't prevent you from working.
If you truly love something, then you'll pursue it no matter how scary or nerve-rattling it is. And you obviously love doing what you do best.
It's so improbable that anybody would be in the voiceover industry. And I'm glad that as a banker and someone who loves math, I never looked at the numbers first. I just fell into it and loved it. Numbers don't matter in that case. I'm sure it's a one chance in a million sometimes, but somebody has to be the one, and there are literally millions of people on the planet. So why not the other one? Yeah.
Mela Lee, voice actress, musician, all-around badass, member FDIC.
banker joke!
I want to quote you on that one.
All right. Oh,
That'll be the tag on my website.
No, you are more than welcome to put that on there. And then they'll go, how'd she get the FDIC in there? Like, well, guilty as charged. But anyway, let's go ahead and open up to some listener questions, because we've got a couple of them. And if you guys want to talk to... Yes, we have to. Wait, what? What? Wait, I'm sorry, what'd you say?
Oh, I just said that would be great.
Oh, okay. Okay, good. I was hearing Shinku for a minute. I was like, I'm going crazy. Okay, anyway, back to Sanity Land. Anyway, our first question is from Vu Manchu. How do you feel about the Fate franchise and Type Moon in general? Also, can you tell her that Rin Tohsaka is best girl? Okay, I'll tell her. Rin Tohsaka, you are best girl.
Rin Tohsaka is the best girl. I loved Rin. I went to a Catholic girls' school and wore a black skirt and red sweater. With a knee-high sock. So when I walked in that room, I thought, oh my gosh, that's my outfit. I loved her. She was smart and precocious and, you know, well-meaning and badass. And who doesn't want to be that?
Oh, hang on a sec, Mela. That gives me an idea.
Okay. Oh, you can tell by the way I wear my skirt that some punk boy is going to get hurt. I may be pretty, I may have class, but it won't stop me from whooping your ass.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I loved the Fate series, and it was so exciting to get to return to the Fate Zero installment and return to that character in the prequel. I never dreamed that I would get to do voiceover, but the joy of getting to do a character long-term or over several years, it's neat to see how I've grown since I started in the business, too.
Yeah, well, just again, you see the recent outpouring of new blood into the voice acting industry. And, you know, you see these kids and you go, wow, this is the new generation that's going to eventually replace me. It's just, well, I don't think they're going to replace you just that quickly, Mela. I think
I might eventually get to play the mom.
But I don't know. I don't know a role. And as much as I like Shinku, I'm still taking back the fact that you were a Mystique in the redubbing for the classic X-Men arcade game.
Oh, how fun was that, right?
And could you say that infamous line that everyone has come to know with that game?
No, I can't. It's copywritten.
Oh, you go! Oh. Oh, see, that's... Yeah, that's right. I don't want to fight
You can it. Say it, and I can repeat what you say.
Well,
didn't sign an agreement.
Well, anyway, for those who don't know, who've never played the X-Men game, there was a 1992 cabinet game, and it was one of those classic games that you couldn't really emulate on a console system. And it was panoramic screen. You had eight players you could play as. And one of the most infamous lines from that game is when Magneto, who in the redub is played by my buddy Kyle Hebert, he goes, mm-hmm. X-Men, welcome to die. And everyone's like, welcome to die? It's like, it's like what does that even mean? Welcome to die.
You're welcome to die.
Yes, and then you had I am Magneto, master of magnet. What? You mean magnets? It's like he should have been I am Magneto, master of pronouns. Come on, use the S. You welcome. And that's still one of the even in the redub. They kept Welcome to Die, because that was just the most
We wanted to be as close to the original as possible.
It was the most WTF moment. But you played Kitty Pryde, Emma Frost, Mystique. Mm-hmm. You know, you played essentially the three only women in that game.
It was very exciting. I remember going, which one did I get? And they said, all of them.
Yeah,
I said, oh. And then it turned out Kyle did all of the men as well. So we're in Wikipedia together, side by side, for all eternity, or at least as long as the internet lasts.
Well, and on behindthevoiceactors.com as well, under the X-Men one as well. So I can only picture Kyle going, no one can stop the blob.
He was amazing. And ironically, I didn't know that it was Kyle that had necessarily done it. We were in Sydney at a convention, and we were doing a Q&A, and you're kind of a little bit jet-lagged and pulled in a lot of different directions when you fly all over the world for a convention. And we landed in Sydney, and it turned out I had the flu a couple days later and couldn't talk for a week, so I was a little dizzy at this point. And somebody said, what is it like working with Kyle Adair? You know, I've seen that you guys have done so much together. And I remembered at the moment there was like 12 people on the stage, and I thought, which one's Kyle? Because we had just met for the first time. A lot of times we will do shows together, but not actually ever meet one another unless we're doing a convention for the fans. And then Kyle, he must have seen that look in my eye, and he said, we loved working on X-Men together. And I was like, oh my God, we did X-Men together? That's you? So I had a fangirl moment on stage in front of a bunch of fans. But he is the real deal, Kyle Adair.
I'm not going to argue with you. He is the total package in voice acting, and I don't think
he
gets enough credit for what he does. He does a lot of awesome stuff. Of course, I don't think anything's going to be better than next time on Dragon Ball Z. I mean that voice,
Dennis,
right?
Let's spend 4 seconds right now all about Kyle, just so that if you ever listen to it, Kyle, we are giving you 4 seconds of this just to admire your amazing talent. For all those people that have missed it, here's your 4 seconds.
Yeah. Well, do you think we should do one?
Okay, we're done.
Well, do you think we should do one for Karen too? Because we've been talking about Karen a lot too.
Absolutely, guys. Karen Strassman, a moment of not silence. Karen, you're awesome. Yep. See, and I don't know about you, Dennis, but high school was not the most fun for me. And now I get to go to work with some of the most awesome people on the planet. And I feel like this is what I thought high school would be like, with these kind of friends who are super funny and super talented. And I wouldn't change it for the world, but I wish I could go back and tell high school Mela it does get a lot better.
Well, I don't know. High school Dennis was pretty awesome. Well, high school Denny was pretty awesome. Except for that time, during the winter pep rally of my sophomore year, I was doing the chicken dance with my assistant principal, and I won the contest. And when I went to take a bow, I fell to my knees and started bowing, and I kind of mooned my entire sophomore class.
Oops.
Yeah, they saw the moon a little early. Oh, yeah. So aside from that, it was pretty sweet.
I'm so glad. See, maybe that's why I get to be a voiceover artist before you. I needed to redeem my time.
Now
there's plenty of room for you. Come join.
I hope so. I don't know if I'd be a good voice actor. I'm just a crazy guy who likes to, you know, just...
I think you'd be good at anything you work hard at.
I think
it's like they've done that equation, Dennis. Haven't you? Look at all the time you've spent. You love the art form. That's the start, right?
Yes, I want to. It's just I'm not making any money off my internet stock, and I don't know how many dozen people we're going to broadcast to with this, but joke. No,
I make very much money in anime the first 5 or 6 years. I'm just excited to do it, but definitely couldn't make a living on it. Yeah. But you know, 10 years in, now I'm making a living. It just took a minute. It's like any other investment. It just takes a second, and you're investing right now. I totally believe in you.
Thank you, Mela. I do appreciate it. And I got people like you and Karen to help me out, and I do appreciate that. But, you know, enough about me. You know, let's talk about these other ham and eggers that they want to be voice actors too. Do you have any advice for those that want to pursue a career in acting or voice acting?
I do. Right now, voice acting is really the term. used to be the a voiceover artist or just in voiceover, but right now with games and virtual reality theater, that I think that's where our medium is going. And you need to be able to actually act. Gone are the days of, you know, the five villain voices. What they're looking for now, with look at all the millions of channels we have on YouTube and the internet. Those are all going to be also game channels and experiences. And they need human beings, real quirks and things that make you uniquely you as a girl or a guy. Find out if you naturally have a younger voice or a hero voice, but then be you and act in that role. Because that's what engages people when they're listening to your voice on a game or in an animated series more and more, because I think we're separate from each other because we're on computers all the time. Those computers have to become filled with the people we used to hang out with now that we're inside. So I've got to hear Dennis's voice or you know, Jeanette's voice or whoever it is out there. There's a tendency, if people love voiceover, to be able to spend lots of time mimicking and trying to be someone else. And you should spend time honing the characters that are super personal to you, that are in your own life, your favorite teacher, you know, your brother, your best friend, that guy at the grocery store is a little bit off. Those are the things that you can characterize that no one else could do like you. Because they're personal. And start to create your cachet of characters that are uniquely yours. And I think if you're a Kyle Adair and you are an amazing mimic, go ahead and put that in a separate bag. But one of the things that makes Kyle so good is he's an actor. He's in it. He loves the moment. He's utterly an 8-year-old boy having the time of his life every time he does a show. And my advice to young people that are, you know, young, if they could be 57, but young in the voiceover industry, is remember to be yourself and to be in that moment and to not do it 5% of the way, but 105% of the way. Be in that world and be sold out for it. And that's where the acting comes in. Nobody likes to watch bad acting. We certainly don't like to listen to it. And I think your enthusiasm, like how you are on the show, is so uniquely you, Dennis. It's amazing. And when I've worked with Tony Oliver, he does, he's a director and voice actor, Tony, that does a voice acting workshop. And we're so amazed sometimes. Someone who has had no experience will walk in at a convention and read a line and everyone just stops because they're so in the role and actually themselves instead of trying to be something else. And it's just brilliant. And then next thing I know, they're in a show with me. And I'm like, oh, I just saw you at the anime, you know, convention in Los Angeles, you know, Anime Expo. And so glad that you're in the industry. Yeah. So that's what I have to say. Be yourself. Actually learn how to act. Find your own characters that you can bring to the table. And I'll see you guys in a few years.
Yeah, but anyway, speaking of conventions, are there any convention appearances you're going to be making in the near future that we can possibly promote?
Oh, gosh, I wish. I do wish I was, but I'm having to spend 2014 concentrating on the music and getting the album out. We can't talk about it exactly, but we've got a new manager and a new PR firm, and 2014 will be a music year.
You got a new manager, too? Huh, that's cool.
It's very exciting.
I just got a new manager myself for the show.
Awesome.
My show manager. Not it's a quote manager. It's Poison from Street Fighter. It's gonna be a running gag on this show. Karen did an intro versus Poison, and it was just so freaking awesome. So we're kind of a character show now. Heaven help us. Okay, well, Mela, before we go...
Are there any other questions, Dennis?
Well, let's take a look here. And no one is hitting us up on the twiddly-diddly-deet.
Okay.
That's kind of a buzzkill. We've got one more from Nico Yuki Hime. And they want to know, who does Mela think is more suitable for Yuki from Vampire Cross? Or Vampire Knight? I guess boy-wise.
Oh, more suitable probably boys. Well, I think I have problems with both of them. I adore that I would have grown up with Zero. But ultimately, Zero doesn't like himself because he has hatred for others and he turns into that thing that he hates the most. One of the beautiful things about Yuki is that she has love for both vampires and humans. So when she goes through a change, she doesn't hate herself for being one or the other. And although Kaname isn't the most awesome romantic choice, at least he loves who he is and he understands who he is. And as much as I would ultimately wish that Yuki and Zero would be together, you can't have a successful relationship with someone that doesn't love themselves. And so I think that's just going to be a heartbreak in a series that continues, that if only he could find acceptance of himself, she could love him too.
So I guess you'd be a Yukiname shipper?
I hate to choose, which is a girl's prerogative. I think the practical choice is Kaname, and I'll leave it at that.
Okay.
And we all know that Yuki's not the most practical girl.
Well, in anime, Mela, who is? I mean, again, back to the list of characters. You play a girl with a gun. You play a bratty doll. You play a girl with a freaking hatchet. You play Welcome to Die. You play, you play Rin, you know.
I win.
Yes, you win. You win the internets and the animes. And I can't wait to see what Maya's going to be like. Heaven help us. It's going to be another. But anyway, we're about to come to the end of our awesome show. So we've been putting it off for all this episode. I think people want to see a little Shinku.
Mm. Well, she was in the other room. She was a little upset, Dennis, apparently.
Oh, hang on. Let me go talk to her. Hang on.
Okay.
Shinku? Shinku, where are you?
Oh, honestly, Dennis, I'm exactly where you left me. Just left me here. I've been sitting here for 45 minutes waiting for you with this horrid tea. You call it tea? It doesn't even qualify as a letter T. It qualifies as a letter blech.
Shinku, I went to...
What?
I went to 5 different stores to get you... Do you know how much that tea cost me? That cost me nearly $100.
Are you whining?
I'm not whining. I'm just stating the obvious. I spent all this money to make sure you had everything. I got you your tea. I got you your little cakes. I got you those coon freaking cozies that you wanted. I went out of my way to make sure you
were... Thank you.
Yes, but you see, you're complaining. I don't even know how that kid puts up with you. You are infuriating.
Are you raising your voice at me, Dennis? I'm a guest. It's not very nice to treat a guest like that.
Yeah, well, it's also not traditional to treat the host like a freaking doormat. Now, I have built backwards because of you. So here is what you're going to do.
How can I make it up to you, Dennis?
I'll tell you what you can do to make it up to me, Barbie. You're going to lift this curse that Suigintou put on me.
Oh, dear.
What do you mean, oh, dear?
Yes. Dennis.
What?
I think she pulled a little bit of a trick on you.
Oh, no. Oh, no. No, no, no. You don't get this chick. She left feathers all over my studio. They're everywhere I go. Glass shatters. And not in the good way, signaling Stone Cold Steve Austin. I am talking. I can't go within 5 feet of any mirror without it shattering in front of me. Now, she did something to me, and I thought you, as one of these Rozen dolls, might be able to help me out. Now, I've been very nice to you, and I'm asking you, please lift this curse.
Close your eyes. Honestly. Pretend you're sleeping.
Hang on.
And dream if you would.
I'm dreaming.
Mm-hmm. La 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 la. Is that helping?
I don't know. What is all this supposed to be doing? I have no idea.
Well, in the dream world, I can help you.
But the dream world, but all right. If we're gonna do this, hang on. I gotta go. Let me go talk to Mela and make sure that we at least send her off on a good note before this before we do this. So hang on, wait right here. I will be right back.
Oh, honestly.
Okay. Well, apparently this is going to take a little longer than I thought. So, Mela, I guess we're going to have to call.
Dennis, somebody just tweeted that you were going to go to sleep with Shinku. What's going on?
Wait, what?
I thought you didn't even like dolls.
Whoa. It's not what you think, Mela.
Huh.
It's not.
Yeah, it says you are going to sleep with Shinku.
Oh boy. Well, I think I've got myself into a pot of hot water now. So, this is going to cost me my sanity. Belle Dandy, if you're listening, please come back. I need your help. But anyway, let's go ahead and wrap this up so I can try to get this cursed out of me. Mela, thank you so much for joining us on the program. It's truly a huge honor, and hopefully we can have you back on to promote anything else going on with Magnolia Memoir.
That would be great. Thanks, Dennis.
So, guys...
You happen to have any tea?
No, I don't drink that crap.
Okay.
Well, she's looking at me. Okay, I'll get some tea, but anyway, I gotta go help out the guests around here. So guys, check out Mela Lee on Twitter at Mela Muse. You can also check out her website, MelaLee.com. And guys, buy the awesome show she is in. They're now available on Amazon for incredibly reasonable prices. We will see you down the road. Until next time, this is the Dennis Daniels Show saying, we'll see you all as we celebrate 5 years of the Dennis Daniels Show. Good night!